So, this is part two of chapter two, and in the previous part, we were talking about the geography of Mesopotamia. And as you can see on the screen, the map of the Central Asia plus the Arabian Peninsula. So, you can see that there are the two rivers, that is the Euphrates and Tigris. And in the geography, you just have to remember that to the east, they had plain areas, and easternmost, there were mountains. To the south, there was desert. And in the southern part, also, there was the maximum production. To the north, there were steppes, etc. And to the west, there was Mediterranean Sea. So, we have seen the geography of Mesopotamia. Just to revise a little bit, I've given you a brief review of the previous part. So, moving forward, now the next subtopic is the significance of urbanism. Now, urbanization, you must remember that urbanization is a process when there is development of towns and cities, and towns and cities are places where the maximum percentage of the population is engrossed or performing professions other than agriculture. So cities and towns are not just places with large populations, but these are actually the economy that develops around activities other than food production, that is other than agriculture, when many of the people of the towns are involved in activities other than agriculture, then that comprises of the urban population. So urban economies comprise, besides food production, there is trade, there is manufacturing, there is services. In economics also, in your till 10th, you must have heard that there are three kinds of activities: primary, secondary, and tertiary. So other than primary activities, when there is maximum of secondary and tertiary activities being carried out in a particular area, then that area is considered to be urban. So this is one of the criteria to understand which area is urban and which is a rural area. So city people thus cease to be self-sufficient and depend on the products or services of other people. So obviously in the city, since there is no I'm not saying there is no food production, but there is other activities majorly, like except agriculture, other activities are being followed. So the city people, they are not self-sufficient, and they have to depend on the people from the rural areas to further manufacture products and services. So there is going to be a continuous interaction among them, that is the urban people and rural people are continuously in interaction with each other, and there is specialization of job. That is, everybody has their own specialized jobs at which they are experts, and they are required to do their duties in order to maintain the balance in the society. So this again shows that in the cities there is a proper division of labor. Everybody has been entrusted with a proper responsibility which they have to carry out, and because of everybody having their own jobs, there is a continuous prosperity being maintained in the cities. Other than division of labor, there is also a social organization in place. That is the people who come from different areas. They also work in tandem with each other. There is organized trade and storage that is required, which is again available in the cities areas. There are deliveries of grain and other food items from the village to the city. Again, I have told you that these raw materials are provided by the rural people to the urban towns, and many different activities have to be coordinated. There must not only be stones, but also bronze tools and pots available for seal cutters. So these are just examples of the things that city people are dependent upon other people from village areas for different activities. So in such a system, some people give commands that others obey. So obviously, to have this kind of an organization, there has to be a central authority which has the power to give commands to the people, which the people have to follow, so that there can be a maintenance of peace and stability in the society. Now, the next subtopic is the movement of goods in the cities. Now, however rich the food resources of Mesopotamia, its mineral resources were few. The mineral resources means things like metals, very precious stones, etc. So even though Mesopotamia had a good agricultural development, but at the same time it was lacking in the other mineral resources like important metals, etc. So there has to be a continuous transportation from one area to another so that there can be a proper supply, abundant supply of these metals and the things which were not present in Mesopotamia. And this was basically done in the form of a barter trade, which means that in return for their agricultural produce, they used to get other such metals which they did not have, other such stones, basically from areas of Turkey, Iraq, Iran. So these were the areas which used to provide Mesopotamia with its mineral resources. But regular exchanges could only be carried out if there was a proper organization of transportation. So to equip foreign expeditions and direct exchanges, also people had formed particular alliances with the foreign countries so that there can be a continuous transformation, uninterrupted transportation of trade and services. So besides crafts, trade and services, efficient transport is also important for urban development. We have already discussed that if there has to be establishment of prosperous society, it needed a proper urban development. With that, there also needed to be an efficient transportation system. So the urban transportation in Mesopotamia was quite developed, and therefore it made the city economy quite viable. The cheapest mode of transportation is obviously over water. We have read that all the time, that water transportation was considered to be the cheapest of all. The canals and the natural channels of ancient Mesopotamia were in fact routes of good transport between large and small settlements. So there was canal transport, and in account of the city of Mari, which is one of the most popular city of Mesopotamia, the importance of Euphrates as a world route will be obviously clear, because Mari was connected to different paths with the help of the river which is called Euphrates. Now the last subtopic for today is the development of writing. Now all societies have language. We have read that there was not like immediate development of language. Even language took a lot of time for its proper development. And language is again a form of verbal communication, but under verbal communication also comes the writing part. So writing is also a kind of verbal communication where you write down your ideas in order to convey what you are thinking. So writing is nothing but actually transforming the spoken language into a visible sign. So every different visible sign has a different spoken sound. So the first Mesopotamian tablets were written around 3200 BCE, and it contained picture-like signs and numbers. Now you can draw parallels with Indus Valley civilization as well. Now Indus Valley civilization is considered to be a contemporary of Mesopotamia. Even there we used to have a pictographic script. That is, people used to write in the form of pictures to convey their ideas. So similarly, Mesopotamian seers have also found some picture-like signs and numbers, and most of these pictures or signs were related to animals like oxen, fish, breed, lobes, etc., which means that these things used to make up majority of the part of the lives of the Mesopotamian people. So clearly writing began when society needed to keep records of transactions, when people were actually involved in barter system with each other. There had to be something to memorize or to keep a track of the different kind of transactions which were being carried out between different people. So in order to keep a record of all those transactions, people started writing, and initially that was the only need why people needed to write, in order to keep a proper account of what kind of transactions were being carried out. So Mesopotamians used to write on tablets of clay. So the clay was wet, and in that wet clay people used to engrave certain pictures over it, which were mostly wedge shaped structures. So when the clay got dry, it used to become indestructible because it became hard and it became more resilient to the changes in the nature. So this is how, and when the written record used to become old and obsolete, people used to throw the tablets away. So once the surface dried, signs could not be pressed onto the tablet. So obviously there was no way that people could meddle with those transactions and could change the records that have already been imposed. So after this, the first initial need for writing was to keep a record of the transactions, but with time people started using this art, that is the letters, the wedge-shaped signs were being used by the people of keeping record of the various words, which became later on became dictionaries. Then they started keeping it to have legal papers for legal transfers of deeds of land, announcing the changes of the kings. And so with time, gradually the writing part was being used by Mesopotamian to keep record of many other things other than transactions, even for the religious purposes, writing down about the people's beliefs and their religious practices. So this is how writing began, and it also started being transferred to the other parts of the world as well. And we have already seen that Mesopotamian writings have also been transferred to other European countries, which started using the writing format in their own courts also. So this is about the writing in Mesopotamia. We also read about the movement of goods, the use or the importance of transportation, and we also talked about what is urbanization and how urbanism was important for Mesopotamia. So this is all for today. We'll start with the next subtopic in the next part. So see you tomorrow. Bye bye.